Hello gentlemen, how are you? Today I am making this video on a particular subject, that is of one of history's greatest warriors who has ever lived, Genghis Khan, or better known as Temujin. So, you know, I received a lot of inquiries from my friends. Like, someone told me, ki Genghis Khan, was he a Hindu or he was a Sanatani? So, then I did a little research. And then today we will be speaking on whether Genghis Khan was a Sanatani Hindu. So really, if you see Hindu religion, which you call the Sanatan, is the eternal truth. It is not a religion. It is basically a way of life. So we don't have a single book like Islam has the Quran, or Christianity has the Bible, or the Jews have the Torah. It is a collection. We have the Upanishads, we have the Puranas, we have the novels of Mahabharata, Ramayana, then we have the Vishnu Purans, Shiv Purans, etc. Similarly, we don't have the concept of a priest, where you have a priest who will be offering the religious services or offerings, or you don't have a particular day to visit your temple or your church or anything like that. So, now, if you really see, earlier the whole world was Sanatani, from the Mayan civilization in the South America to the Red Americans who were in North Africa, or the Arborangis who were in Australia. So basically, Genghis Khan was following the Tengri religion. So Tengri religion is a subsect of the Sanatana Dharma, and he basically belonged to the Hunas and the Sakas. So if you see the Hunas and the Saka, these tribes came in India around 2500 years ago from the central steppes, from the area where it is Azerbaijan, Iran, Tajikistan, Uzbekistan, those areas. And then they blended into the Hindu philosophy and Hindu culture, and it became a part and parcel of India. In fact, one of the greatest rulers was Mihirakula from the Hunas, who was an ardent devotee and a Shiv Bhakt. So if you really see the religion of Genghis Khan, he was a follower of the Tengri religion. So he was, let's not speak on Genghis Khan. Genghis Khan was basically known as Temujin. His father was Yishugai, and he was the leader of a tribe known as Khyat Borenjin. And they used to worship nature, that is the sun, the blue sky. And even today, if you go to Mongolia, the most famous symbol, like we have got the Om, they have the Temdeg symbol. I will just show you in my slide the Temdeg symbol. The Temdeg symbol is basically a swastika. And like we have the concept of the Kailasha, they used to worship a holy mountain which was known as Mount Burhan Khaldun, where Genghis Khan regularly used to go and pray to Tengri. Now Tengri. Tengri is basically an angry god, a Rudra avatar of Shiva. So in those ways you can say that he was a follower of the Sanatana Dharma. Now, you know, digging more into like whether Genghis Khan was a follower of Sanatani Hindu Dharma or not, let's now go to, more to the Tengri religion. So if you see in Mongolia, there is a lake which is which is known by the name of Ganga. In fact, it is said like the holy waters of Ganga were poured there by a gentleman, and even today it is known as Ganges. The Mongolian flag, just have a look at the Mongolian flag, you can just see in the slide. See, it is basically, it has a Vedic Havan Kund, you see, where we do the worships, you know, yajnas. On the fire worship is a very, very major part of Hindu religion. The same concept has been borrowed by the Zoroastrian or the Parsi religion, where they are ardent fire worshippers. So there you see this. There is a Havan Kund which has got the Yin and Yang. Now Yin and Yang concept of the Chinese is again of Shiva and Shakti. So Shiva becomes Yin and Shakti becomes Yang. With the sun, the Rudra and the half moon, Devi, rising above the symbol. So, and if you have a great look at the basically Genghis Khan, you saw he basically conquered half the world, but he never invaded India. Now many people have asked me, what is it, why, you know, Genghis Khan never invaded India? So you see, Genghis Khan never had any requirement of wealth, or he never had any greed of wealth or woman. Like mostly, you know, leaders basically they look for something, either territorial expansion, wealth expansion, or woman. The one thing which differentiated Genghis Khan from other rulers was his anger. He was a very, very angry person, and no one could hurt his ego. So all his, you know, expansions or fights are basically modeled after two things. One is he shouldn't be challenged, no one should hurt his ego, and second was revenge. So the first fight which Genghis Khan had with external enemies, like first he conquered the whole of Mongolia. He defeated all the other tribes. He united some of them by marital alliances. Some people he defeated. And then he brought the whole of Mongolia under his control. Once the whole of Mongolia was under his control, then he started his expansion plan. So if you see his wars, basically, the first war which he took was against the China. The China, a part of China which is known as the Western Xia, the Mongol conquest of Western Xia. The second, again, it was past of the Chinese, which was the Jin Dynasty. He conquered the China of the Jin Dynasty. Now, what was Mongols' enmity, Genghis Khan's enmity against China? So, Chinese, you see, they had tortured the Mongols a lot. They never wanted the Mongols should unite. So, they used to, you know, add like a fuel to a fire. And they used to make tribes after tribes fight with each other. So, you know, there were fights among the tribes which the Chinese used to facilitate. And whenever there was any leader of the Mongol tribe who wanted to unite the Chinese, it was the Chinese who used to kill that leader. So, Genghis Khan had a lot of enmity and a lot of badla lene ki bhavna, what you call, against the Chinese. So, he basically fought the Chinese for revenge. So, he defeated the Western Xia, he defeated the Jin Dynasty. Then he had the conquest of Kara Khitai. Now another area where you see Genghis Khan, he was very brutal. What with the Muslim invaders. Now understand the dynamics. First, Muslims conquer the whole of Arabia. Then they move towards Iran or Persia, which was known as that time. So Persia was basically a mix of religions. There was the Zoroastrian, there were Hindus, there were Buddhists. Majority was with Zoroastrians, around 70-80%. They were on 10-15% Buddhist and 5% Hindus. Now they start conquering one by one. One by one cities start falling to the Muslim invaders. And slowly the whole of the Iran or Persia comes under Muslim rule. And they start persecuting the Zoroastrians. So they are not able to do fire worships. There is a lot of torture on them. And slowly this persecution moves from the Zoroastrians to the Buddhists. Mostly at the area of the Bactria, the area near Azerbaijan. There, persecution moves on these Buddhists. And among the Buddhists, there is a sect which is the followers of the Mihirakula, which is from the Tengri tribe, and they are the followers of the shamanism. The Buddhists torture them also a lot. Yeah, the Muslims torture them also a lot. So they then move from Azerbaijan to towards upper regions near, you know, the present day Mongolia and all. But the torture doesn't stop. So inside, you know, Genghis Khan had a feeling, he had a revengeful feeling against the Muslim invaders. Now the tip of iceberg, what happens, you know, the firing point or the boiling point is, he sends a group of merchants and some caravans for business or trade with the Shah of Persia. And who was the basically the king of the Khwarezmid Empire. And what happens is these traders, they are insulted. They say some insulting words for Genghis Khan. And all these traders, they are made bald headed and then sent back to the Genghis Khan with most of them killed. This hurts Genghis Khan a lot. I mean, he's firing, he's boiling with anger. Like his caravan has been killed, his traders have been tortured, some have been tonsured, they have been made bald headed. So now he thinks on a campaign for the Iran and the Horusite Empire. So he basically gets a Karava, he basically gets an army of around 10 Tumans. 10 Tumans is around 150,000 soldiers, all horse riders. You know, and another thing I would like to add, the Mongols are very great horse riders, and they have got very number of horses and very strong horses. Now they then invade Khwarezmite Empire. They lay cities after cities fall to the Mongols. The fortified cities which are not able to defend themselves are easily breached. Their walls breached and they are broken down. So he then, out of anger, he burns the whole of Persia. And then he moves to Baghdad. He burns the library of Baghdad. Kills each and every citizen there. In fact, it is told during his Iran Empire or that Khwarezmite Empire, around 1.5 crore to 2 crore people have been killed. And then he comes back. So as these things are happening, so the next thing what happens is, his attention turns to India. So India is a very rich state at that time, the richest empire in the whole world. It's easy. He comes to the Punjab near the Sindhu River and suddenly his mind changes. He turns back. He does not invade. He leaves that running prince of the Khwarezmite Empire and he turns back. Now, what are the conclusions which people think, like, why did not Genghis Khan basically invade India? The first thing is, see, there was no point of enmity or revenge against India because Indians had not done him any wrong. And he had his own old Sanatani culture of not provoking anyone or inflicting pain on anyone unless he inflicts pains on you. So these are the conclusions, you know, which basically make him change his mind and he does not invade India. So this is all the story of Genghis Khan, why he did not invade India and was he a Sanatani or not. Hope my video makes you happy. So, and it is Corona times. So take care of yourselves, be safe, stay indoors. Thank you.